Coming up, Christian music's Lindsay McCaul.
You finally see his face and find your rest.
Why she sings.
I want to share that hope and that truth with other people.
And the message in her music.
He is worshiping his risen Savior face to face.
On today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Welcome to 700 Club Interactive. As an up-and-coming young singer, Lindsay McCaul has toured the country with a who's who of Christian artists. Her sophomore album, One More Step, has drawn rave reviews within the industry, and with good reason. Lindsay pours her heart out in every song. Once she wrote after she endured the worst season of her life.
My dad and my mom went to the doctor in Florida and discovered that he had myelofibrosis, which is basically a blood cancer. And I was just stunned, just shocked and devastated. I was actually in Florida with Matt Maher. I was opening for him just for a couple shows. My mom called and said, you know, I just really think you need to come. I just think you need to come now. I remember so vividly driving to the hospital being like, I'm driving to say goodbye to my father. Like, this is the person that I've known my entire life. At that point, he was really getting really weak. He had been in so much pain that week, so much pain, which is the hardest part. It was just watching him endure that and not really being able to do much to help. Our last conversation was just, you know, him saying, I love you. And I just said, I love you, Dad. I'm so thankful for you. And I am forever grateful for that, that time that I had with him.
Sitting by your side, I said, you are. It's one more step, blink your eyes, you'll be home on the other side. Running down the golden streets, you'll hear a million angels sing. So one more kiss on earth is all that's left.
We played at Auburn University, where my dad went to school, and there was a moment. You know, we got on campus and I was like, oh, I should call Dad and tell him. And then it just kind of really hit me that I can't call my dad and tell him anymore. I knew in my heart, and I carried that with me, that just things are different now. I wanted to remember my dad and not be afraid of mourning and sadness and being sad sometimes. And you just can't really predict, you know, which day you're gonna be sad on or what's gonna remind you. I would just go hang out at home and or even on the bus, and people knew that when I was on tour, they knew that sometimes I just needed to be quiet and spend some time reading the Bible or reading a book. Somehow I came upon that verse, Psalm 34:18, which says, the Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. And it just meant so much to me, and I just really clung to that. God understands, and he's close to us. Our pain is not lost on him. A good friend of mine and another artist named Jason Gray, he just said that pain is a holy experience because if we allow it, God uses pain to draw us closer to him. It makes us choose where our confidence is. I knew that I loved the Lord, and I knew that he said he was faithful. If I had never walked through these seasons and through these valleys, I would never have realized who it was with me. It's about choosing, am I gonna choose to go to despair, or do I choose to trust what I say that I believe in and trust the person that I say I've given my life to? For me, grieving with hope has just been remembering that I'm not alone in this. You know, God is with me and he's giving me grace for each moment. And I've tried to make a habit of writing out things I have to be thankful for so that I can see it with my own two eyes and not miss what God's doing in my life. The first Easter after my dad passed away, I just remember being in church. And I was, at first I was walking in like, oh, this is my first Easter without my dad. I just am so I miss him so much. And I just remember realizing, like, my dad is standing face to face with the person who Easter is all about. He is worshiping his risen Savior face to face. I mean, like, my dad is not sad that he is not at this church service. He is at the best Easter service ever. And I just remember just God totally flooded my heart with peace and joy. So that was definitely a turning point for me, just realizing my dad's not in pain anymore. He's healed and whole and free, and he's having the best day of his life right now.
Before the breath of heaven fills your chest and you finally see his face and find your rest.
There's that deep joy, even in the midst of missing him in sorrow, that deep joy of knowing I'm gonna see him again, and I want to share that hope and that truth with other people.
One more step.
May you, if you've lost a loved one, may you find the God of all comfort, and may he come to you and give you a vision of what your loved one is going through now. The great joy that there is in his presence. The Apostle Paul said something really remarkable. He said, to die is gain. The reason? Because if you're absent from the body, you're present with the Lord. If you're a Christian, if you believe that Jesus came, that he died for you and me, that he lived the perfect life, that he was the perfect sacrifice for all sin, for all mankind, for all time, if you believe that. And then if you believe that he rose again from the grave, well then to die is gain because you're with him. And it's the greatest Easter service, it's the greatest sunrise service, it's the greatest day of your life. And that is truly good news. And that is the hope of our calling, the hope of the resurrection, that we get to stand and see him face to face and behold his glory. And Jesus, the reason he did all of this, for the joy set before him, that's what the Bible says. He endured the cross for the joy set before him. So for him, it's the fulfillment of his sacrifice when he gets to see you face to face with him in heaven. If you are grieving and you just want to pour out your heart, we're here for you, and we're here for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. All you have to do is call us, 888-777-1999. Well, Lindsay McCaul's album is called One More Step, and you can buy it wherever music is sold. We've had some of our friends on Facebook tell us that they've gone through similar times as Lindsay, and they've got some questions. So let's go over to Jessica in our chat room to find out more.
Well, Gordon, we do have some prayer requests in from Facebook. Here's one from Reza. She says, my eldest daughter passed away last year. She was only 12. My husband and I have had a hard time. I know we have to move on, but I'm worried that I'll begin to forget her. What should I do? Gordon?
The Bible actually asks a question, and this is God. This is the prophet Isaiah quoting God. Can a mother forget her nursing child? Can you forget the child that you gave birth to, that you nursed, that you cared for? Can you ever forget? And he's using it as a comparison to his love for Israel, that can I ever forget you, Israel? Can I ever leave you behind? Can I, my memory ever be gone of you? And the answer is clearly no, that mothers never forget their children. And here's something for you. Jesus knows what it's like to die. And because of that, God knows what it's like to lose a child. So the God of all comfort, he knows what you're going through. And he will comfort you. He will. And you can look forward to the day when you will be reunited with your child. That day will come. You will see them again, and it will be a day of great joy. Let's go back to Jessica for one more question.
Well, Gordon, we've got another question in. Denise says, I lost my brother last year. He left behind a wife and two children. I try to help them and pray with them when I can, but my sister-in-law has started to reject my help. I think she's walking away from God and blaming him. I'm worried I'm making things worse. What do you think, Gordon?
You may be trying to fill a role you can't fill, and that is you'll never be him. You'll never be a husband to her. You'll never truly be the father to the children. And as much as you want to do that, and I think your heart of compassion is good, I'm not trying to say that's wrong to feel that way, but start realizing you're never going to be able to do that. And your role is uncle. And so as an uncle, as a brother-in-law, what can you do? And just sending the message, we're here for you. If you need anything, just let us know. And remember the important days. Remember the holidays, Thanksgiving, Christmas. Remember the birthdays. Remember to celebrate their achievements. Remember their lives. And in those moments, it's perfectly acceptable for you to show up and extend a hand of love and help and stay involved. But if you're trying to be father, I would urge you to take a step back from that. And if you're trying to be husband, definitely take a step back from that one. You'll never be able to fill that role. So don't even try. And realize the role that you do have is a meaningful one. And do it to the best of your ability. Well, you can always be part of the conversation on our show by just liking our Facebook page. All you have to do is go to facebook.com/700clubinteractive. If you've got questions about the topic for the day, we'd be glad to answer them. If you have prayer requests, we'd be glad to pray for you. Well, still ahead, the NFL halfback who's been running his whole life.
I was close to my deathbed because of asthma. I cried, and that was a tough moment in my life. I woke up one day and said, I'm going to run and get in shape to the point where I can outrun asthma.
Hear what makes this New York Giant stand tall when we come back. Sold for Sex, the true story of a teen who became a stripper and then a prostitute. The founder of Eve's Angels tells us about dancing for the devil on the next 700 Club Interactive. They call the NFL the not-for-long league. The average career of a player, just 3 years. 2.5 years for running backs. So in his sixth season in the league, Big Blue's Rashad Jennings has already exceeded expectations. Not too bad for a guy who used to be a self-described dorky kid who once spent time on his deathbed.
Playing at a position that's dependent on footwork, Rashad Jennings has quickly gained traction in his new lead as the Giants' starting running back.
I'm fighting to prove that I'm a complete back. That's somebody who can catch the ball out the backfield, knows how to protect the quarterback, do everything, fourth and one, fourth and goal, third and long, second and short. There's no reason to come off the field.
Both versatile and ready, he's a renaissance man in cleats. His teammates have playfully nicknamed him, quote,
one that I stand strongly behind is, you know, the master in the art of living shows little distinction between his labor and his leisure, his mind and his body, his love and his religion. He simply pursues excellence at everything he does, leaving others to determine whether he's working or is he playing. But to him, he's always doing both.
After playing 4 years in Jacksonville and one in Oakland, Rashad came to New York as a free agent.
So I'm curious about a lot of things in life. Well, being in New York City, I'm just like a kid and getting to know the minds of some of the people who are responsible for the things we see daily. He's been preparing me everywhere he's taken me. And now to be in New York as a Giant. I had to overcome many Giants to now actually become a Giant. And so I'm thrilled, I'm humble, I'm excited, that God wanted me in New York for whatever reason, but I definitely see his hand on my life.
What is it about this NFL platform that accentuates your spiritual growth?
Distractions help me grow. You're either gonna be distracted or you're gonna distract somebody. If I can recognize distractions, it's a good thing. I only can recognize them when I'm headed in the right direction. I try my hardest to live from the reference of scriptures and let that be my, you know, mirror. Every day, I gotta be able to look in the mirror and say, that's the guy that I'm trying to become. And I always tell people, there's nothing special about me. Is I'm in a special position.
But the positioning comes from a place of strength after Rashad maneuvered around and through childhood obstacles.
I was hospitalized, and I was close to my deathbed because of asthma. Barely could breathe. The doctors told me that I'd never be able to play sports. I cried, and that was a tough moment in my life. Through prayer and determination, I woke up one day and said, I'm gonna run and get in shape to the point where I can outrun asthma.
And he has, with no setbacks. His breathtaking success has since become a second wind of encouragement for those overcoming medical hardships.
What does your name mean?
Rashad means a wise counselor. I think we all, at some point in life, find our shoes being inside a counselor. It's just whether we're aware or taking ownership over it in that particular time.
Rashad's time came as a freshman while in college at Pitt, when his dad lost his legs to diabetes. Rashad returned home to Lynchburg, Virginia, transferring to Liberty University, where he had a distinguished collegiate career.
When my father had his legs amputated, I couldn't do nothing but cry. Couldn't even fathom not having legs. Doing what I do for a living as a running back, it would be impossible. Every time I see my father, I see a picture of him, I'm always reminded that I have them, and so I must run. In life, I'm always gonna be running because of the things I had to overcome.
For an NFL rusher whose legs run hard and thoughts run deep, you'd think a New York arrival meant his career was finally hitting stride, but not Rashad. Hitting his stride came from that very first lesson when he learned to never be caught flat-footed.
When opportunity presents itself, it's too late to prepare for it because that opportunity is in that moment.
Rashad learned a valuable lesson during one high school game.
I was the short, fat, dorky kid with glasses and asthma. I rode the bench. I didn't have anything looking up. Like, I really did not play. We're playing against our high school rivalry. They went through a variations of injuries, so they absolutely had nobody else to turn to. And I remember the coach yelling, Rashad, get in the game, get in the game. Go in, first play, first carry, 30-yard touchdown. 14 plays, and I scored 4 touchdowns, 2 on offense, 2 on defense. And at the end of the game, that Tennessee scout who came to watch the starting tailback, he pulled me aside and said, Rashad, I couldn't help but to notice you, but you got potential. Now, when opportunity presents itself in every aspect of my life, when nobody's looking, I'm always preparing.
And always learning, a self-taught discipline that started in college.
I'm always trying to figure out how do people do what they do. So I wanted to pick up a new craft. Outside of what I was learning and outside of football. I taught myself how to write my left hand, played the guitar, and then I learned every card trick I could figure out. Why not? We will never be 100% excellence, but there are moments in our life we can exercise being excellence, and that's only because of the love of Christ. And I have to be perfect, and I have to, and then the measure of it and what it looks like, the perfection was lying in grace for us to fall in mercy and understand who Christ is.
Rashad Jennings, the thought-provoking running back, whose steps follow his Savior in a never-ending run.
What is it about Jesus Christ that wins you over daily?
I see a man that was perfect. I see a man who knew where he was going. He wasn't ashamed to live for something bigger than himself, and who wasn't fixated on deteriorating anybody's faith to bolster his, but he was so convicted in his faith that he made everybody else question theirs. He's a man of love, he exemplifies it, and he's somebody that I want to follow.
Words to live by. Rashad truly is a man of wisdom. Well, he's just one of many Christian pro athletes, and you can hear the testimony of others by just going to cbnsports.com. Still ahead, a special showing of Superbook in Beijing. with Chris, Joy, and Gizmo speaking in Mandarin. Plus, get a sneak peek at the latest Superbook episode, Elijah and the Prophets of Baal. Well, our goal for Superbook is to show the stories of the Bible to the children of the world. And recently, we held a special screening in Beijing. And here's what children there had to say after they watched the story of the crucifixion.
Hello!
That is Superbook, but it's in Mandarin, translated especially for the children of China. CBN aired He Is Risen on the internet in China this Easter, and we set up a special screening in Beijing for Rong Mei and her friends to find out what they thought of the animation.
I could hardly wait to see the new Superbook. I knew it would be full of nice surprises.
I especially like the part where Gizmo travels through space in the time tunnel.
The characters' faces and emotions look so real, and the clothing looks just like it's from ancient Israel. You can even see the folds on the clothes.
The children were glued to the screen, especially during the crucifixion scene.
I could tell that they were really concentrating on what they were watching. Some of the kids were even shaking when they saw Jesus' hands nailed to the cross.
After seeing He Is Risen, I learned that He had to die so that He could rise again, and there's nothing more powerful than that.
I learned from Chris that I should listen to my mom and be obedient to my parents, to my teachers, and to God.
These children can hardly wait for more Superbook episodes to be translated into Mandarin.
It would be great for the kids to see more so that they can learn the whole Bible.
I believe that Superbook is one of God's plans to let kids all over the world know Him.
Look, if you don't have much to give, then just give a little. But please give as much as you can for Superbook, because we're waiting to see more.
Children love Superbook, and you can be a part of sharing the stories of the Bible with children around the world. Our goal is 42 different languages in our first year with this series, and so you can be a part of it by just joining the Superbook DVD Club. It's number on the screen, 888-777-1999. If you'd like to join, it's just $25. Every 4 to 6 weeks as new episodes are released, and we'll send out the latest to you right away. If you want to get caught up, just go to cbn.com. Now, here's a preview of our newest episode, and it features an epic story in the Bible, the showdown between the prophet Elijah and King Ahab and the prophets of Baal. Here's how it's depicted in Superbook.
King Ahab!
Who dares speak to the king of Israel this way?
It is Elijah, prophet of the Lord.
You have done evil in the sight of the Lord. You have built temples and altars to the false god Baal, and have done more to make the Lord God of Israel angry than any king of Israel before you.
Prophet, you
are... I am the servant of the living Lord, the God of Israel, and I swear in His name that it won't rain except at my word. There won't even be any dew on the ground.
I don't need your God for rain, prophet. Do you really think Him a match for Baal, the god of weather?
Increase the sacrifices until Baal hears our pleas for rain. Then bring me the man responsible for this drought.
And if you find any other prophets of the Lord, kill them!
Search everywhere, but find Elijah.
Well, there's a preview of the latest episode. If you'd like to get it, all you have to do is join the Superbook DVD Club. The number's on the screen, 888-777-1999. When you sign up for the DVD Club, we'll send you the latest episode as they're produced. We're in season 3 right now. As soon as it's completed, you'll be first to get it. You'll get not just one copy, you'll get 3 copies, so you can share it with your family, share it with your church. You can be part of giving it away so that others can hear the stories of the Bible. And if you want to get caught up on past episodes, we've got 26 out so far. Season 1 and Season 2 are already completed. All you have to do is go to cbn.com. and you can order the back episodes. Do it now. Be part of bringing the stories of the Bible to the children of the world. That's all the time we have. We leave you this word from Psalm 18. For it is you who light my lamp. The Lord, my God, lightens my darkness. God bless you. We'll see you again.